Germinal Libertario Middle. Organ of Expression of the Anarchist Youth of Lyon. Feature: What is Marxism? Before beginning the critique of the principles and results of Marxism, we consider it necessary to ask a question that apparently has the character of a riddle, but which is amply justified if we take into account that the defenders of this doctrine claim that only it offers the necessary homogeneity leading to a coherent activity in the struggle for human emancipation. This question is the following: What is Marxism? We will see later that, based on the texts of Karl Marx himself, it can be answered in very different, even contradictory ways. For now, let's limit ourselves to certain immediate practicalities, which really influence the story. In 1936, before Franco's triumph, there were three known currents in Spain: the Socialist Social Democratic Party, which was the most important, the Official Communist Party, and the Workers' Party of Marxist Unification, PUM. Each of these currents claimed to be the only valid one, the only authentic representative of Marx's thought. But the Communist Party called the members of the Spanish Social Democratic Party traitors, and claimed that it violated the sacred principles set forth in the Communist Manifesto and Capital. To which the leaders and theorists of socialism who continued Pablo Iglesias, Jaime Vieira or Pablo Lafargue responded by denouncing the deviation that consisted of trying to carry out socialism in an insufficiently industrialized nation, and implanting the dictatorship of the proletariat when the conditions did not exist. Socio-economic character, concentration of capitalism, important development of industry and the industrial proletariat, technical progress in agriculture with the elimination of archaic forms of land ownership, indicated by Marxism as sine qua non conditions of socialization in accordance to the supposed scientific concept of socialism. The PUM responded to these two currents, and with it the Trotskyists, half-hearted PUMists, who violated the principles of Marxism, on the one hand, those who did not want to carry out the social revolution as soon as possible, on the other those who wanted to carry it out according to the norms applied by the Official Communist Party, which, following Stalin, violated the principles of Marxism-Leninism. Only the PUMist or Trotskyist interpretation of Marxism was the good one, the authentic one, the indisputable one. Today, we have the Stalinist Communist Marxists, the Trotskyist Communist Marxists, the PUMist Communist Marxists, the Mao Tse-Tung Communist Marxists, the Togliatti Italian Revisionist Communist Marxists, the Khrushchev Communist Marxists, and the different Trotskyist currents. We forgot the Titists. But, historically, and on the world level, currents and undercurrents have been multiple for many decades. Divided and opposing schools, and interpretations, each of which claim to be, in its own way, the only indisputable interpreter of Marxism. Until the Russian Revolution, reformist and semi-reformist Marxists, revolutionaries and semi-revolutionaries clashed everywhere. In Russia itself, the Bolsheviks with Lenin, Chicherin and Stalin, the Mensheviks with Plejanov, founder of the Russian Social Democracy, and Martov, in the middle of whom was Trotsky, who dealt blows left and right. They fought savagely and accused each other of right and left deviations. In Germany, the homeland of Marxism, the revolutionary tendency led by Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht fought hard against the reformist social democratic majority whose main theorist was Bernstein. In between the two was the semi-revolutionary and semi-reformist trend led by Karl Kautsky, the most notorious Marxist of the time, whom Lenin had to beat a good deal by calling him the traitor Kautsky when he saw that his German opponent refused to approve of the Russian Bolshevik seizure of power. As will be supposed, Kautsky demonstrated, on the basis of an orthodoxy no less indisputable than that of Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht, that the other two tendencies betrayed the thought of Marx and Engels. The discussions did not revolve only around tactical problems, since every authentic Marxist must always give a scientific, philosophical and doctrinal grip to the least of his gestures. They referred to theoretical questions related to the strategy always authentically Marxist that of them it derived, for example, to what were primarily due, and according to the scientific and dialectical Marxist method, the crises of capitalism. Some argued that these crises began with an excess of raw materials. Hilferding, a brilliant German theorist, affirms that this origin should be sought in monetary and financial problems, while Professor Tugan Brenovsky, a Russian Marxist who will be discussed later, affirmed that the explanation more certain was the inability of the market to absorb the volume of industrial production, a general thesis of economists, but seasoned with Marxist sauce. In all European countries, in France, Italy, Belgium, etc., less in England where socialism was never Marxist, despite the fact that Marx wrote his work in London and took the development of the English economy as the basic material of his socialism, the currents struggled and remembered the disputes, and the oppositions of the Christian churches, Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox and Heterodox, discussing the divinity of Christ, the meaning of baptism, the value of confession, the sanctity of the Pope or the virginity of Mary. And if we remember that these disputes led to the wars of religion, to the extermination of the false Christians by the true ones, we can consider them unimportant. In Bolshevik Russia they have led to the total extermination of all non-Leninist or Stalinist Marxists, and of all non-Marxist revolutionaries. To these great currents must be added the small ones. They were innumerable. Julian Gorkin, who in 1936 had separated from the Communist Party while remaining a Marxist, recently told us how he had been commissioned on that date to establish in Mexico a link of contact between some 15 opposition and minority Marxist parties, all European. Naturally, each one also pretended to be the only accurate interpreter of authentic Marxist thought and demonstrated it, quotes to Song. Let us finally mention certain Marxist syndicalist nuclei represented by Labriola and his friends in Italy, by the Sorel of Certain Times and his friends in France, by Argentine Union Nuclei, the internal currents of Italian socialism, and those that were formed within the Russian Communist Party installed in power, opposing others Lenin, Trotsky, Bukharin, Zinoviev, Alexander Kolontai and Klapnikov. These last two carriers of the tendency workers' opposition, whose defenders assimilated Lenin to the petty bourgeois and anarchists. It is known that the Marxist-Leninist tendency appeared later. Marxist-Leninist-Stalinist that the official communists of the whole world claimed, for 30 years, to be the only just and authentic after having affirmed, with equal sincerity, that the Leninist was also the only just and authentic. We have seen afterwards appear the Khrushchevian tendency, no less just and authentic than the preceding ones. And at this moment, the post-Khrushchevian trend is being worked out, it will be no less Marxist, just and authentic, whatever the path taken. In short, the current Chinese school of Marxism is for its supporters, the only valid interpreter of Marx's thought, as is the current Italian school, revisionist of what its members have proclaimed to be the only Marxist truth from 1917 to 1961. But against it stands the not only Leninist, but also the Bordaiist trend created in 1939 by Bordaiker. What is Marxism? Luck is for those who believe they can answer with confidence, because if it were possible to gather all the representatives of all the schools, in order to put them in agreement, such a cacophony would occur that the Tower of Babel itself would be, at its side, a model of unity and harmony. This does not prevent that every Marxist fraction is convinced of having the only indisputable truth about the interpretation of historical or dialectical materialism, the evolution of society, the present and the future of humanity, the political strategy and the appropriate revolutionary tactics in each nation, the mode of realization of socialism, the stages that must be traversed through the revolutionary or parliamentary seizure of power, good or bad alliances, the degree of patriotism, anti-militarism, nationalism or internationalism that should be applied, advances in one direction and the setbacks in another, the use of the state. And, a wonderful thing, for each of these positions, no matter how contradictory, one can go to Marx. There are more interpretations of Marxism than hairs on the teacher's beard. But, undoubtedly, the whole constitutes a beard. It may be objected that all political and social schools have different, and even opposite, tendencies. It is true. But liberalism, republicanism, non-Marxist socialism, anarchism, trade unionism, have not been founded by a single thinker, creator of a doctrine that has given him his name. The diversity of thinkers and theorists explains the diversity of trends, and above all each one of them does not claim to possess the only truth, while due to its origins and its scientific and dogmatic claims, Marxism should present a unity of thought, cohesion theoretical and practical activity between theorists and sub-theorists, commentators, activists, interpreters and various parties. The multiplicity of its forks proves the bankruptcy of its real content. There is no one Marxism, but pluralized Marxisms in constant conflict. These contradictions should make those who believe they have found in him the only common thread for the interpretation of history to reflect. Gaston Laval. The Fallacy of Marxism, 1967. Gaston Laval, original name Robert Piller, Paris, October 20, 1895, Paris, April 16, 1978, was a French anarcho-syndicalist, combatant and historian of the Spanish Social Revolution.